gentlemen, and this, I think, will appeal. We opened our show the other day, and now again with what you call what is of the moment. I tell you all the time that I deal in nostalgia, but I dabble greatly in what is of the moment, and the rock adherents out there, the rock addicts, would love to be reminded that in such magazines as Heavy, as Metal Mania, that one of the facts of life is that a young man named King Diamond has sold so far, and he's from Denmark, 150,000 albums, LPs, cassettes. He's a man with a very royal-sounding name, Keith, and that his name is King Diamond. And King, can I shake your hand and say that it's it's a pleasure. And so let me ask you, first of all, your main market, I think, is in America, not even in Denmark, based on a few of my friends here who
That's right. America's our main market. Then Germany, Holland, Belgium.
Right.
But Denmark is so tiny, we don't actually have a heavy metal scene there.
Nothing like that, huh?
No.
Can I ask you, when you were born, what name was on your birth certificate? Was it King Diamond on the birth certificate?
Yeah.
You serious?
Yeah.
You believe that, Keith?
No.
You don't? What do you say, Ed?
Could be.
Ed is a policeman in the from Irvington, New Jersey. He's the rapping policeman. He's going to make an album soon, too. So this is King Diamond. If I went to Denmark, would you show me around?
Sure, anytime.
Where would you take Keith? We'll get around to music. Where would you take Keith and Ed and me if we
to
went?
Copenhagen.
Through Copenhagen, right.
So you would have to see the Little Mermaid.
Right.
You'd have to see Tivoli.
Tivoli Gardens.
That's an amusement.
You might be King Joe, too.
How about a performance of Hamlet?
You could watch that at Kronborg, yeah, the old castle.
Right. Was he the prince of Denmark?
He was the prince of Denmark, yeah.
And you're the king. You're the king of Denmark.
Yeah, so he was not as much as me.
May we ask you when you first became exposed to a man who sold 150,000 albums quietly, at low key, you know, low profile. When did you, in your hometown or your home country, become first aware of and then a fan of rock and roll, King Diamond?
I guess it was in 69 when I heard the first real raw guitar on an album. That's when I got really interested in the music business. But at that time, I was playing soccer on top level in Denmark. But finally, I had to make a choice because I couldn't do both. I couldn't play a gig Saturday night and get up early Sunday morning and play soccer.
He's so nice. I thought he was going to sit here and I thought he was going to scare us. He's such a nice. You left home to paint the war paint, right?
Yeah.
Why is it so incongruous? My feeling about heavy metal in Denmark. I think of Denmark society as being so calm and tranquil and peaceful, and the way you just said
it really is.
Tivoli Gardens, but hard hitting, driving, forceful heavy metal.
It's the only way to get out of aggressions.
Really?
Country. Yeah.
You know what I'm saying, Keith?
I do indeed. But they have it all over the world, though. They're, you know, all of these people all over the world now, Joe.
Which American musicians are in the Hot 100 on the charts, if any, in Denmark? Any American...
lots of heavy metal acts. Alice Cooper, Judas Priest, Ozzy Osbourne, they're all there.
And King Diamond?
Well, yeah, we're getting there.
What are you doing in this country right now? Visiting a few of your friends or making arrangements?
That as well, but mostly it's a promotion tour.
Mm-hmm.
Doing interviews and radio stations, TV.
Who's famous from Denmark besides you? And besides who? Victor Borge, we got to mention.
Oh, I was about to...
Who else? Name some entertainers.
Entertainers. Not very many, actually.
Political figures?
Schlüter might be famous, but I don't think he means very much over here.
Mm-hmm. Is there a big difference, Mr. Diamond, between American rock and... Danish rock, or European rock, let's say.
Yes, there is a difference. The American seem to be more commercialized than the European style. The European style is like you have it's a raw sound that the European bands have got than the American bands.
King Diamond, what do you have on your belt there? What is that?
That is empty ammunition.
Empty ammunition?
Yeah.
Oh.
Joe, I think he's misappropriated a few of my bullets.
I've got a flight to Florida later on, too.
Oh, I see.
Get rid of all those cockroaches.
Between your ammunition and the fact that you're sitting alongside the Irvington policeman who's known to be rapping cop, we're secure, right?
Yeah.
Now, King Diamond's concept is so interesting, but it's contradictory. Heavy metal rock music with classical influences for discriminating audiences. It sounds impossible to me, but how do you make that happen? It's horror? You break
the
it
show,
down.
Yeah. The lyrics on the new album is one concept horror story from the beginning to the end. You know, it's never been done before in that way. And our show is very, very, there's a lot of things going on, and we really try to scare the audience.
How many in your group?
We're five people in the group. We got two guitarists, a drummer.
Little bit of one of this man's records. I can only tell you that everybody says to me, Joe, you got to meet King Diamond. He's got a retinue there of beautifully dressed people, and I'm sure that they're well paid from your royalties, right?
Oh, yes.
You're supporting a lot of people. You know that?
I know that.
A little bit of King Diamond and the new release, or the current release, and it goes like this, and I'll say it again, a big, big seller, this time without his makeup. It's not going to scare anybody. Just a touch of King Diamond. This forthcoming concept of yours here, one big horror story from beginning to end, how would Stephen King's fans appreciate that concept?
I think they really like it. It's a very intriguing horror story.
That's kind of a first in rock and roll, though, isn't it?
It is. It's the first time that somebody has made a concept album with a horror lyric to it.
This man seems to be more athletic, Keith, than any athlete. Based on his wild gyrations, he's more than any athlete.
With what he goes through.
How do you maintain that energy level? How do you keep it going like that, King, when you do those tours, those concerts, huh?
Well, I try to sleep as much as possible during the tours to be able to perform in the right way.
Ladies and gentlemen,
it's definitely
I can only say that I'm a fan of this young man from now on, and I can see why the excitement. What label?
Roadrunner Records.
And if I go over there, how does the American dollar do over there? Would you say the American dollar is respected in Denmark? Is it?
At the moment, it's like this.
Back and forth, right?
Yeah.
Ladies and gentlemen, I want to do a tape right now by Keith Morris, who will set the scene for Sport.
King, hvordan er det at være heavy metal musiker i Danmark?
Det er meget stilfærdigt. Det har været i de år, jeg har spillet. Indtil nuværende tidspunkt, som om der er ved at ske noget i øjeblikket. Som om bladene er ved at få øjnene op, radioen er for øjnene mere op, og nu også tv med hensyn til heavy musik. Men det har ligget meget dødt. Vi har været et par år tilbage, som så vanligt.
Jeg tror, det er fordi
Hvorfor bliver publikum kropsvisiteret, inden det går til heavy metal-koncert?
Krav, som bliver stillet fra bands, tror jeg, til arrangøren, fordi man vil undgå piratoptagelser med folk og små båndoptagere med bånd og så videre. Jeg tror ikke, det er så meget våben, man går efter. Det tror jeg ikke. Bagefter og sammenholdning, det lyder sørme godt, ikke? Men det kan jeg ikke sælge herhjemme, så det må vente nogle år eller sådan noget lignende.
Men I har jo lavet plader.
Ja, så må man gå til udlandet. Så sendte vi demobånd til nogle gode forbindelser, vi havde i London, som så har sendt det videre ud til Holland og andre lande, og vi fik altså en kontrakt med på et lille hollandsk selskab først.
Fra Pretty Mate. En anden markant dansk heavy rock gruppe er Mercyful Fate.
Den her sådan er lårbenet fra et menneske, og her er skinbenet. Og det er så formet som et kors, hvorpå mikrofonen bliver sat på her. Den fungerer som mikrofonholder, i stedet for alle de her sædvanlige mikrofonholder, man altid ser. Ikke? Der er noget specielt over det her, der er noget stemning over det.
Du og dit band Mercyful Fate bekender jer til satanismen. Hvorfor gør I det?
Det er hovedsageligt på grund af min interesse i det okulte, som ved det, at jeg skriver alle teksterne til bandet, så er det mig, der selvfølgelig påvirker det tekstmæssige. Altså, jeg skriver alle teksterne, så jeg skriver om mine store interesser. Det siger mig ikke noget at synge om motorcykler og den slags ting der, det gør det ikke. Min hovedinteresse efter musikken, det er simpelthen okkultisme. Så har vi en bog her, Det er Satanbilen. Og den har jeg altid med mig, når vi turnerer rundt omkring i verden. Og den ligger altid på vores alter, som også er en af de ingredienser, vi har med i vores show. Og for at snakke mere om det alter, så har vi også på frontsiden to korslagte gåsefjer siddende, som vi påstænker menneskeblod på scenen. Blod, som bliver tappet fra en af vores roadier. Og det er altså et satanisk ritual, som via hvilket vi byder Satan velkommen til vores koncerter og prøver at få ham ind i den koncertsal, hvor vi er, og få ham til at nyde det, vi laver sammen med alle de andre mennesker.
Jeg ser tit folk stå med højre arm sådan og svinge tak til musikken i koncerter i Danmark.
Ja.
Sådan et tegn her.
Det er tegn, ja.
Hvad symboliserer det nu? Eller symboliserer det noget overhovedet?
Det har en gammel mening, som betyder, at det er en hilsen for de indviede. Men nu er det gået over til at blive tegn for satanisme, ikke? Det er geden af de to horn. Der skal være show, der skal være noget visuelt, og vi prøver selv at spille på endnu flere sanser hos folk. Ikke kun det visuelle og ørerne, men også det rent følelsesmæssige. Mm-hmm. Vi vil gerne have en lille skræk i livet på folk, når vi spiller, ikke? Fordi det giver dem noget ekstra, også når de sidder hjemme og hører pladen, og det var det, der skete der, og det er sket der, det er sådan noget.
Skræk i livet?
Ja, giv dem en, så de bliver en lille smule bange på visse tidspunkter af showet, fordi det igen, så kører det på nogle helt andre sanser hos mennesker, som giver mig en endnu større oplevelse, end de ellers ville have, hvis de bare stod og kiggede sådan.
Hvordan gør du det? Hvad gør I det?
Det er blandt andet, at vi brænder kors af på scenen, som giver folk, har jeg fået at vide, efter koncerter, en meget speciel følelse. Ikke noget med kulturklær og den slags ting, det er intet med det at gøre. Men det, at de ser levende på scenen, det giver dem noget specielt.
Hvad mener I om den del af heavy-musikken, som fokuserer på det okkulte og på satanisme?
Ja, altså det er ikke noget, vi gør ret meget i. Men dem, som tror på satan, de skal have lov at tro på det. Men altså, okay, tror man på det gode, så må man også tro på det onde, ikke? Men jeg mener ikke, der er nogen grund til at tilbyde det. Det synes vi i hvert fald ikke.
Folk i udlandet giver sig mere til musikken. De reagerer kraftigere på det, man siger til dem, og mens man spiller musikken, så der er en meget kraftig reaktion.
Oh my god! Who are you?
King Diamond. It's not cracking up.
Ah, yes, hello. Sorry, I didn't recognize you with the makeup on. How are you? All right?
Fine.
Sorry, this is King Diamond. Grobble Bell. Actually, would you like to talk?
Sure, why
should
not?
Should we talk, you and
yeah,
me?
Sure. Okay.
You go and talk a moment.
All right,
I'll catch
bye,
you
Mick.
Later.
Yeah, I'll see you around. Bye. Michael Schenker Band, armed and ready. And I'm talking to King Diamond. Hello, welcome.
Thanks a lot.
I'm sorry about not recognising you. That makeup is stunning. Do you do it yourself?
Yes, every time.
So what brings the former lead singer of Merciful Fate to London?
We have a new album called Fatal Portrait coming out in
Britain on the 14th of March. It should be out worldwide on the 14th of March.
And actually, I must say, that's what you can hear playing in the background, Lurking in the Dark, from the album Fatal Portrait. What actually happened to Mercyful Fate? Why did they split up?
We split up on the 12th of April, the day after we played our last gig in Copenhagen.
Yeah.
Mostly due to an unprofessional attitude from certain members of the band.
I see.
You know, the kind of stage clothing. Somebody didn't want to do the interviews and in-stores that I needed to make a career and dressed up too funny, you know, like short trousers and stuff. It didn't fit in with the show. But most important was the musical side of the whole thing, because the former guitarist Hank Sherman, who used to write most of the songs,
he came
up with new material which had nothing to do with Mercyful Fate at all, and he insisted on getting on the next album. It was pure pop music, and I wouldn't put my name to that.
Because it was doing so well at two, wasn't
yeah,
it?
Yeah, definitely.
Really
we just
it.
Came back from touring the States for 2 months, you know, and did some festivals in Germany between Christmas and New Year's Eve, and everything went perfect at the time.
So you left, you took some members with you, and you...
I phoned up the guys the day after the gig and told them that I was leaving Mercyful Fate, and then the bands broke up because of that, and
so
I gave them
the
a couple
band?
Of days to think it over, and then I phoned two of the old guys, Michael Denner and Jimmy Hansen, the bass player and guitarist, and asked them to come and listen what I had to say about the future and stuff, and they joined immediately.
Is it similar to the Mercyful Fate, or is it like that Satanist heavy metal?
There are some slight changes. The music, you will instantly hear that it's Mercyful Fate. It could have been our third album.
Yeah.
But in order to get better deals for the band, we had to change the name, and we picked on King Diamond because everybody knew that already. So concerning the image, it's still going to be the same. You're going to see a far bigger show production. You'll see illusions on stage instead of the ordinary stuff we used to do. There's not going to be so much Satan into the stuff now. It's going
to
be more magic and mystery.
That's
I'm going to be burned alive on stage, for instance.
Oh, I say. We'll talk more. I know you've chosen this week's Mega Monster mix for us. It's Lee Arum, Metal Queen, Motley Crue, Queensryche. This week's Mega Monster Mix, Lee Arum, Motley Crue and Queensryche, chosen by King Diamond. What do you think about bands like Exodus and Slayer?
They're very good personal friends of mine.
Yeah?
I don't know how much they believe in the real thing, but I know they read the book.
Yeah?
Yeah.
Well, thank you very much for coming to see me.
You're welcome.
I'm going to try and pronounce a name now. Wendy Malmsteen.
Oh, Amanda, you stupid woman. Try again.
Malmsteen?
Yngwie Malmsteen.
Yngwie Malmsteen, sorry. I'll see you tonight. Lots of luck.
Thanks.
Mercyful Fate. Why doesn't Mercyful Fate exist anymore?
Because I left the band right after our last gig, which was in Copenhagen on the 11th of April, and it was due to a lot of things, mostly the musical side of the whole thing, because Hank Sherman, the earlier guitarist, used to write most of Mercyful Fate songs. He totally twisted over his musical attitude and wanted to play very poppy music. And I heard material which was supposed to be on the third Mercyful Fate album. It just didn't fit Mercyful Fate at all.
Because Hank Sherman is now in a band called Fate, who are much more commercial than Mercyful Fate ever was.
Definitely, yeah. So that was the main reason. And then again, you know, there was something to do with professional attitudes, the way people dressed up on stage, you know, it just didn't fit into our show.
Yes, he was wearing strange clothes, wasn't he?
Short trousers when we played in Washington, you know, he very often appeared in a pink jogging suit, and people was looking really weird at the guy and saying, is he in the band?
It's a bit of a contrast with what you're wearing.
Yes, very much, you know, and he could just wear ordinary jeans, that would have been okay, but not even that. So he didn't want to do interviews in stores. You know, it was really a lack of professional attitude. So something had to be done, especially about the music for the third album. Then we changed the name to King Diamond, mainly because we wanted to get better deals, better contracts for albums, and you know, merchandising, all those things. So it was necessary for us to change the name, and King Diamond was the most obvious name for us because everybody knew that name already.
Right, and King Diamond, apart from yourself, also features two other ex-members of Mercyful Fate too.
Michael Denner on the guitar and Timmy on the bass.
Right, so how does King Diamond differ from Mercyful Fate? What's different about this new band?
The show, for one thing, is going to be very different. We're going to use a lot of illusions. We've discussed things with the magicians in Copenhagen, and it's going to feature a lot of illusions. People are going to see me burn alive on stage, for instance. That's one thing. Won't reveal all the stuff now, but there's going to be things happening that people don't understand is possible. So that's show-wise. We're going to take a lot of the satanic stuff away from the show, build in more magic and mystery. The same thing has been done with the lyrics. We've erased the word Satan and Lucifer from our lyrics because the word Satan actually stands for the powers of the unknown, and that's what I'm still writing about in the lyrics. There is one very long horror story going over 5 songs.
Yeah, we're talking about the new King Diamond album,
yes.
Fatal Portrait.
Yes,
yeah.
Definitely. Yeah. So in that way we've approached another, gone into trying to get a bigger audience, bigger approach to the audience.
Yes, because in Merciful Fate you were singing about Satan, Lucifer, whatever you want to call
yeah.
him, quite a lot,
yes.
and mentioning that in interviews, and I think that put
yeah.
a lot of people off listening to the music.
Yeah, it was really only the hardcore fans that were into our music, and we'd like to get more people interested in our music. Again, the music have changed a little bit, but it's like a natural improvement from our last album, Don't Break the Oath. Mm-hmm. This one could just as well be the third Merciful Fate album. We tried to make the songs more fluent. A lot of people didn't like our rough cuts in the music, and we sort of erased those rough cuts. It's been more fluent, but there's still loads of weird rhythms, and there's probably more guitar solos than there have been before.
When you were in Merciful Fate, you were asked to talk an awful lot about Satan when you did interviews, because
yeah.
you sang about it in the music.
Yes.
And I think you were kind of misunderstood, actually.
Lot of times, yes.
Just for the record, let's get it straight. What are your beliefs? What sort of code do you live by?
There is a book written by a guy called Anton Santalavey, who lives in San Francisco. In 1966, he came up with the first real established satanic church in America. And he's written a book called The Satanic Bible. And that book is a book I can go for 100%. And it explains 2/3 of the book is pure life philosophy. The last third is about magic, and it's not like people think, just all about being evil. It's about accepting both evil and good. Preferably 90% good, 10% evil.
Diamond Band, but King Diamond is very much a band more than just your solo project, isn't it?
It is a band, yes, very much so.
And it's ex-members of Merciful Fate, I think, are part of King Diamond, aren't they?
Yes, we have still got the bass player, Timmy Hansen, and we had Michael Dana up till a few days ago. He left the band a few days ago
oh, really?
Because he couldn't take the strain of touring anymore. He told us that he didn't look forward to the upcoming American tour, and he wanted to get out of it, relax, settle down in Denmark, and he's going to open up a second-hand record store.
Oh, is he really? So he's not going to play anymore then?
No, not at all. He said to us that if he couldn't play with us, he would rather stop, and he couldn't take that strain anymore.
Well, having heard the new album, Abigail, and read the lyric sheet, I would say that it's a concept album. Would I be right?
It is a concept horror story, yeah.
So
fiction.
What is a concept? Tell us very briefly, what's the story behind Abigail?
It's about two young people who are inheriting a mansion, and there's something very weird going on in this mansion. They see some ghosts who tell them weird stories, and you hear about what happened in this mansion a long time ago, and all these events sort of happen again. The story takes place in 1845, and you go back into 1777 at a certain point, but there's so much happening there.
So
it's really complicated, very intrigued story.
It sounds it. Is it something you've made up, or is it based on historical fact?
I made up the whole story myself. There's one thing, though, that I borrowed. There was an American fan who sent me a photo of a gravestone, and there was a girl called Hannah Alsop who died 7 years old on the 7th day of July, 1777. I used that date. And I used the name of her mother, which was Abigail.
Right.
I used that in the story. The person in the story is a stillborn baby.
Right.
So that it differs a bit, but that's the only thing I've taken from anywhere else.
Well, although the story is essentially fiction, is it a story that could actually happen in real life, do you think?
In my opinion, yes, but a lot of people would believe no.
Right. Well, we should mention this, because in the past, particularly, I think, on Merciful Fate records, you sung about Satan and the devil, call it what you will, but Abigail is more of a horror story. Has that been a conscious move away from talking specifically about the devil?
In a way, a lot of people have misunderstood this all the time. They still misunderstand this word, and that's why we took the word away already with the former album, Fatal Portrait. So this time we just, you know, it was like a big challenge to me to write a full story for an album, because I've never done that before. This is the biggest thing I've done lyrical-wise. So it was like a challenge, and again, I think that it'll go easier across as well to the audience, because they know that this is a fiction story.
Right, but I think in the past you certainly worried some people who thought you were rather an evil person.
I know, yeah.
Are you an evil person, in fact, King Diamond?
I don't think anybody who's really met me would say so, but there's probably still some people out there who think so.
Well, I know that you used to play football, and anyone who played football certainly couldn't be an evil person, in my opinion, anyway.
Not really, no.
Football fan.
No, that's right.
Now, what about touring? Because you've been over in America quite a lot. You had plans to go to Japan, and you've been in Europe too. What sort of a stage show can we expect to see from King Diamond?
There's going to be, you know, from the Merciful Fate era until King Diamond, we took it quite a lot further. There was a lot of illusions incorporated in the show, and we're taking it even further on this tour, where people are going to see me burn on stage.
Really? Can you set yourself on fire?
Yes, and the makeup is going to change during the set, and we're going to play the entire new album on stage. So that's going
to
be...
So when can we expect to see some shows in Europe, do you think?
First of all, we start in America in early July, and that'll last for a minimum of 10 weeks. The gear has to be sent back, that'll take at least 4 weeks. And then we start touring in Europe, and by then, the album should have proved its sales, so that, you know, promoters get interested, so we might get a chance to get to Britain as well.
Well, we certainly hope to see you in the UK, and it is a very good album, well worth everyone checking out. Thanks for joining me today, and we'll end with one of your favourites, your second favourite single, I think, after Alice Cooper.
Right.
And this is Ozzy Osbourne and Crazy Train.
King Diamond was in town recently to promote his new album, Conspiracy. We caught him at a record signing at Shades Records in London.
It's totally ridiculous. I received this letter from his lawyers out of the blue, totally. And it said that it had come to their attention that I had recently begun to wear makeup, and that it was very similar to that of Gene Simmons, which, you know, I've never in my life heard any fan or anybody not being able to see the difference between whether it was Gene Simmons or King Diamond he saw a picture of. Never in my life. I can see that on the Abigail album, for instance, my makeup is symmetric on each side, but when we did the Them album, it's even totally unsymmetric. So I don't know where he got that idea about. Furthermore, it said in the letter that I had adopted certain mannerisms of his, which I certainly hope not. But if I'm really moving around on stage like him, my God, that would be terrible. But the thing is that, just to make it totally ridiculous, the King Diamond show was supposed to be a copy of the old Kiss show. It's always straight where they stopped. The same characters come back here. Actually, Grandma's not very active in this new story. She's only appearing as a part of them, as a spirit. Missy is appearing as a single spirit, you know, very active in the story. But the main characters is my mother and Dr. Landau, who are the ones who are making up this conspiracy, where they bring in the local priest they try to get rid of me, and they succeed in the end. And it's a weird thing, because you see me die on the back of the album, you see me, it looks like my funeral, you know. And every night on stage, I'm gonna die, you're gonna see an illusion called Burned Alive. And there's so much going on in the story, people should read the lyrics and find out, because there's so many, you know, hints from one song to the other, and from this album to the last album, so it's really complicated just getting in there and cover a little bit of it. The song we've chosen for our video is called Sleepless Nights, and was recorded in Los Angeles just like the album, but at a different studio, of course, an old movie studio.
and it's in black and white, and I was like a little bit, why? But then again, you know, they have incorporated 30% of old horror movie footage, which the scenes, the whole scenes of these footage clips look exactly like this, the built stages that they've made for us, you know. So it looks like the whole thing was filmed the same place and really fits in well. There's a lot of good clips that really show what's going on in the lyrics, you know, or in the entire story. And it's an extremely heavy video. Running a boot takes so much time that it's, you know, King Diamond comes first of all now. And maybe once when we're not doing King Diamond anymore, it might be an idea. I'd definitely like to do it. I'd also like to get involved in production, you know, producing albums for other bands. But that also takes time, you know, and the same thing I said, like, if we could have a movie made based on these two albums, Them and Conspiracy, that would be my biggest dream, you know. We're gonna go after it for sure, because I know some directors were very interested. They are not directors who have major budgets, and that's what it would take, either that or nothing at all.
King Diamond left us with this t-shirt and this album to win. All you have to do is answer a simple question: from what country did King Diamond emerge from? It's easy. Send the answers on the back of a postcard to me at the Power Hour. The address will be shown at the end of the show. Here's something a little less conceptual but equally brilliant. Here's King Swamp and their re-released single, Is This Love?
Just die. You will die. Now die. that's fine.
Yeah. Hey, hold on. Y'all hold him up.
Even if it's turned all the way down?
That's bad. Hey, hold up that death poster. Hold up that death poster. You can hear him.
At the show.
Yeah. Huh? I'm a good theater again.
Will it let you?
Yeah, let me see my death poster.
Yeah. No,
we won't even look.
We're on video.
He won't look until we show, not until we see the video.
Yeah. Where? Where? Tell me where.
Hey, I have a VCR and my mom's not.
This here is your average youngster today. We have the couple of the year here. KPFT, Satanic Radio. Get this autograph.
Can't stand
your burden. Oh yeah. Let me get it close. I can't see all of it. Hey, I tried.
Okay.
Okay, quick.
Quick.
Down. There you go.
How's that?
That's perfect.
That's
I'm here following you. Tell me if I'm gonna run into somebody.
Yeah. I got a lot of people.
Alright,
9467536.
Alright. 9467536. Yeah, that's okay. It. Okay. I'll
remember,
I'll watch it.
Is that the chick you got right there, the blonde?
No, the one, see the one in the top red and black Traverse Stripe, the Hurt City? Yeah. Come here and check it out.
You
get back in
there.
It's right here.
Oh!
See, he's a disc jockey for KPFT.
Hey, man, I want in.
I sure am.
We are best friends here.
How's that
look? We are best friends.
Let me see. Yeah. Ooh, I like that. Please, I won't show nobody, I promise.
I will.
Come here and look down.
Hold on. Let me get it focused.
Hold on. You got it?
No. Hold on.
Sure you don't.
Okay.
How's that?
That's Wes's. Okay. We got it.
Very good.
What about it?
Okay.
Come on, Shaw. You got it.
Come on. We got to see everything.
Here.
You know?
here. All right, I'll be nice there. But you ain't got no, I got a bra.
That ain't big, that ain't enough. Come on.
Hey, what's that video gonna be on?
Down.
MTV, my TV. Did you lose your ticket? Yeah, my TV on MTV.
Less than a few hours.
Hold it.
We're gonna show it on Channel 8.
Oh, this is awesome.
What about her?
Hang on.
What'd she get?
Ticket. Yes, I lost my ticket.
Fuck.
Fuck.
Say it.
Lost my ticket, man. Fuck.
Go buy another one.
Man, I don't want to spend any more money. I want to buy a shirt. Mike?
I don't think she's offering
it. Why are you taking pictures of it?
Huh? Why not? I ain't taking pictures of them, I'm filming them. It's not for me, it's for them. They wanted me to.
You ever heard of Sweet Nightmare? KPFT?
This is an exclusive interview. We have your... I'm serious. KPFT, Sweet Nightmares, disc jockey. Have you ever heard of it?
No.
Would you like to listen to it?
You suck then.
Now tell them when it's on.
Sure.
What?
What about you? Not really. He's a disc jockey. KPFT. See the shirt?
Most.
Yeah.
You know you're constantly recording.
I know. He's just like...
A lot of people. One, I'm gonna get a salmon.
Excellent video y'all put out.
Let me hit.
Very good. I thought it was great. You're looking for some more.
Yeah. Good. Good band together.
I think I'll get you signed this epic album here.
What's that?
To Dennis.
To Dennis, sure. I got that poster back home. You know?
Yeah, I know.
What room number?
666.
Yes.
666.
666.
Which one?
Number 9.
Did I get it for me?
King Dash, yeah. Stay heavy forever. Hey, you think it'd be alright if I took this to the show? Yeah.
That's illegal.
Okay.
The company would hang us if they knew.
Yeah, that's alright.
Whatever happened to guitar is Mark
with Danny?
Hey, Jack. Thanks a lot.
Oh, sorry about that.
Okay.
This is a very erratic camera on its white balance.
Yeah. It takes forever, too.
Okay. That's cool.
We use those Sony.
Yep.
Yeah.
Oh, wait a second. Do it all over. I wasn't taping.
You weren't?
No. Sorry about that. Just hold that up.
Thought I didn't hear it quick.
Okay.
Excuse me.
What are you doing here, my God?
Some inside on the vinyl.
Sure.
I already signed a couple of those.
Some ink out of them.
Yeah.
Woo!
Yeah.
Goddamn.
Oh.
I'm just a stand-in for McCain.
Here
you go.
Is it hard for you to maintain the same kind of merciful fate rhythm with new musicians?
Yeah, next.
Next year we have to go a couple of days before then, yeah. But they trash all the places so we won't be able to play there.
Maybe your own little
place. Yeah, it is. Yeah, hometowns you always get, you know. Oh, there's another basement down there. There are a lot more famous
people. That's right, we'll be here with Metallica.
Yeah, but not the remaining
albums. Forget the 1980
albums.
Yeah,
I'm not.
What
are
you
doing
back here? What are
you
doing
back here?
Hvordan fanden havde han også regnet med, at vi kører fra Portland til Vancouver?
Samme dag som vi gik, ja. Eller på natten.
Ja, ja.
Samme jævla väg upp igen. You watching Live Meltdown or?
What's it what?
So Live
this is
Meltdown?
King Diamond
yeah.
For Live Meltdown.
You're watching Live Meltdown. Stay tuned.
Thank you.
Thank you. eternal deal. You will ascend to the grave. You'll give us the house back and keep in mind that we only come here at night.
What is the situation between you and Gene Simmons at the moment?
Well, I'm not too fond of the guy anymore, you know. He's an beep.
Is it ridiculous?
It is totally ridiculous. No, I had a lot of respect for these guys, you know, I always liked them. But after I had these letters from his lawyers, it was so ridiculous. I was accused of wearing the same makeup as him, and I've never heard anybody not being able to tell the difference when they saw pictures of him and me. Everybody can see the difference there. I was also accused of moving like him. On stage, you know, and that's not true. And
Does he move on stage?
He's trying. But, and also our show was supposed to be a copy of Kiss's show, and that is...
Thank God it's not.
yeah, that's, you know, I liked the old Kiss show, great, you know, all the flames and all this stuff. It was interesting, but that's not what we're doing at all. It was totally ridiculous. We told the press everywhere about it, you know, and in America he was made such a fool of.
Is it all over now?
It's all over. It was all over pretty quickly after he saw all these things in the papers. So, but again, it was, I don't know, publicity stunt, whatever. He wanted to get some publicity. They shouldn't need that, but, you know, it gave us a lot too. So, thank you, Gene. Anytime. Rocks up!
Vi skal lytte til Sebastian og hans musik, og vi skal stille spørgsmål til Janne Helle.
Og hvis I også har nogle spørgsmål til aftens emne, parforhold med stor aldersforskel, så kan I ringe ind til os fra nu af på 31 46 03 19. Og så kan jeg fortælle, at i studiet der kan I møde skuespillerparet Grete Holmer og Benny Poulsen. Og sidstnævnte, altså Benny Poulsen, er 18 år yngre end førstnævnte Grete Holmer.
Og så står der en herre her, som, hvad hedder du?
Jeg hedder Kim Bendix Petersen.
Aha, og hvorfor står du her?
Ja, jeg skal være med i anden del af programmet.
Nå,
så er det herovre, det, så ved jeg godt. Ja, undskyld,
så kan det være Isabella,
du hedder jo også noget andet.
Ja, jeg hedder også Ken Geimer.
Ja, og du er satanist?
Ja, det er 100%.
Men ved du, at der er nogle præster, blandt andet en, som kommer i studiet i aften, som mener, at det, som du gør, det påvirker de unge i en forkert retning?
Ja, det ved jeg godt. Det skal vi snakke om. Netop om, jeg har en dårlig indflydelse på ungdommen.
Har du det?
Vås.
Det er vås?
Ja.
Okay,
og så er spørgsmålet igen om hvad satanisme egentlig drejer sig om, og hvad det ikke drejer sig om.
Det skulle du meget gerne fortælle os om senere.
Det skal
og
jeg
det
gøre.
Tror jeg, at tak. Vi får svaret på i anden del. Der skal vi høre nemlig mere om, hvad satanisme er for noget, og også hvad præster synes om det. Det sker i anden del. Cirka 10 minutter i 10, når vi vender tilbage. Vi vender også tilbage med Hugo, hvor der jo stadig er 75.000 kroner på spil.
Og nogle af de unges tanker tager udspring i musikeren King Diamonds musik og tekster.
King Diamond hedder i virkeligheden Kim Bendix Petersen og bor i Hvidovre. Han er 34 år og uddannet kemilaborant. Siden gennembruddet som heavy metal musiker i 1981, har han erklæret sig som 100% satanist. Det vil sige, han tilbeder Satan.
King Diamond er mere populær end de fleste nok vil være klar over. Han sælger 300-400.000 plader årligt på verdensplan, og her i fanklubben kan vi mærke det, vi får mange henvendelser. Vi får en 6-7.000 minimum om året, og det er tal, der stiger hvert år. Der er mange, der synes, de har været til en god koncert, så er der mange, der måske gerne vil købe en t-shirt. Og så er der igen breve af lidt mere alvorlige karakterer. Vi får faktisk overraskende mange breve fra folk, der siger, at hvis det ikke havde været for King Diamond, så havde de nok begået selvmord i dag.
Og velkommen hertil, King Diamond.
Ja, tak.
Du er satanist. Kan du ikke prøve at forklare os, hvad er det, du tror på?
Jo, det er jo meget forskelligt fra det folk, de traditionelt har som opfattelse af det. Det drejer sig hovedsageligt om at leve sine følelser ud i livet, uden at føle, at det er syndigt på nogen måde. Det drejer sig blandt andet om, at selvfølgelig har man stolthed. Alle mennesker har stolthed. Det er noget, der står i Bibelen, at det må man ikke have. Bare det, du har taget en fin jakke på i dag, det er stolthed, fordi man skal vise sig over for andre mennesker. der er en ting, som man skal vende den anden kendt til. Det er ikke humant at vende den anden kendt til. Altså, hvis der er en, der rørte min bror, for eksempel, med en flaske i ansigtet eller sådan, jeg skulle nok få fat på ham.
Du går ikke ind for næste kærlighed?
Absolut.
Nå.
Jo, men jeg vender ikke den anden kendt til, hvis der er en, der laver noget med mig. Så skal der ske retfærdighed. Det er en ting. Næste kærlighed, jeg elsker i allerhøjeste grad dem, som jeg har nær og tæt på mig. Dem elsker jeg tifold. Men jeg spilder ikke min kærlighed på folk, som jeg ikke kender. Det er jeg ingen grund til. Jeg vil hellere give al den kærlighed også til de mennesker, som virkelig betyder noget.
Men I ligger også meget betydning i de ukendte kræfter. Har du haft nogle oplevelser med de kræfter?
Absolut, ja. Det har jeg. Det var det, der sådan set satte mig i gang med at studere lidt mere og prøve at finde ud af, hvad det egentlig drejede sig om. Helt tilbage, hvor vi startede bandet, der hed Merciful Fate, der havde vi lavet vores første demobånd, og trommeslageren og min egen bror var til stede i min lejlighed, og vi ventede på de andre, som kom forbi og lytte på. Og så min brors glas rejste 30 cm op i den blå luft og ned igen. Og det var ikke noget med, vi havde siddet og snakket om det, masse psykose og alt det her. Sådan. Jeg har haft masser af mærkelige oplevelser. Folk er blevet taget af ingenting i min lejlighed.
Hvor kommer satan? Altså ordet satan, det er jo også ind i billedet.
Ordet satan står jo og betyder jo direkte modsat eller omvendt. Og det er derfor, at korset er vendt omvendt, som man kan se. Altså korset vender den anden vej. Og det betyder, at det står for det omvendte, og det satanisme er meget det omvendte af, hvad kristendommen står for.
Det er ikke også netop noget med det onde, det symboliserer vi tit satan med.
Altså, satan, når du skal ind på det spirituelle, drejer sig om de ukendte kræfter. Det er ikke den kristne Gud eller den kristne satan. Det er to guder inden for kristendommen, der intet har med satanisme at gøre.
Okay. Så skal jeg høre Jesper og Robert. I sidder her henholdsvis 16 og 17 år, og I har været fans ret længe, kan jeg forstå på det hele, af King Diamond. Hvor længe har I været fans?
Jeg har været 3-4 år nu. Næsten 4 år snart.
Hvor tit lytter du for eksempel til tekster og musik af King?
Jeg gør faktisk hver dag. Så 3-4 gange om dagen.
Nå, det var meget. Nu kalder I jer begge to satanister. Hvordan har I fundet frem til, hvad det egentlig er? En ting er at sige, at man er satanist, men også at finde ud af, hvad det er og hvad det står for. Hvordan har I fundet ud af det?
Jeg startede det hele med, i skolen, der skulle vi studere religion, ikke? Og jeg har altid haft interesse for det okkulte, ikke? Så jeg valgte det og fandt ud af, det var egentlig mere end hvad jeg troede det var, og fandt ud af.
Hvad fandt du for eksempel ud af om det?
Det er samme som King nævnte her. Ikke vendt den anden kendt til, vel? Så man en fejhund, ikke? Eller hvad man vil kalde det.
I har ikke været nervøse for, at der er noget farligt i det, i de kræfter?
Nej, det har vi ikke. Altså, man ved bare, at man ikke skal gå for langt med det og sådan noget. Altså.
Men vil I gerne følge den ideologi, der ligger bag?
Det vil vi.
Ja, det vil vi godt.
Så sidder her en præst på Folkekirken, Ole Skjærbæk. Det, som vi hører her, Robert og Jesper for eksempel siger, at de sådan flørter med satanismen. Er det usædvanligt blandt unge?
Jeg synes, der er en stigende interesse for det okkulte. Der var lige en stillstand for vores tid siden, men nu er det blusset op igen. Der kommer mange henvendelser fra skolerne om det.
Er det noget, der bekymrer, eller er du ligeglad som præst og siger, lad dem dog bare lege med det?
Det er klart, det bekymrer. Ikke fordi jeg ikke forstår, at der skal lidt spænding ind i tilværelsen, men også fordi jeg synes, der kommer nogle andre normer ind, som jeg ikke synes er særlig spændende. Det med ikke at vende den anden kendt til, det synes jeg egentlig for eksempel er et meget godt princip, fordi det betyder jo, at man ikke tager sig selv til rette, men at man har tid til lige at tænke over tingene og hvad man egentlig skal gøre. Det kan godt være, at der er en, der reagerer ondt mod en, som gør det af en desperation. Hvorfor ikke lige vente og tænke sig om en gang, før man reagerer?
Nu er der mange af os, der tit er skræmt over ordet satanisme, og man tror, det er noget ondt osv. Er der noget farligt i, at unge fyre som Robert og Jesper begynder at beskæftige sig med det?
Det tror jeg nok, der er, fordi noget af det, mener jeg, bygger på indgang i det, man ofte kalder den astrale verden, som jeg vil oversætte til drømmeverden. Og det vil sige, at det bliver en verden fuld af illusioner, som man bygger op, i stedet for en virkelig forankring i det liv, vi lever med de problemer, der rent faktisk er.
Hvad hvis man laver nogle eksperimenter med de ukendte kræfter? Det er jo også det, der interesserer de fleste.
Det kan gribe en, altså, og jeg har da selv mødt mennesker, der er kommet galt afsted med det.
Hvordan?
Ja, altså ind på sindssyge hospital, for eksempel.
Det mener du kan blive en konsekvens, hvis man leger med de her ting?
Ja.
Mener du så, at King Diamond, som jo altså optræder og fortæller, at han er satanist, bærer et ansvar for det, der sker hos de unge?
Ja, det mener jeg gør, fordi han udbreder jo en ideologi gennem sine sange. Han siger ganske vist, at den satan, han dyrker, er det modsatte. At ikke have noget med kristendom at gøre. Alligevel så tager du stilling i nogle af dine sange og siger, at Kristus er en bedrager. Så i den måde relaterer du det jo til Kristus, og dermed siger du alligevel den satan, du har, at han er netop det modsatte af det kristendommen står for, den kristne Gud.
Så hvis jeg siger dig før, at der findes to forskellige satanisme. Jeg ved ikke, om du nogensinde har læst den bog, der hedder Satanic Bible. Har du læst den nogensinde?
Jeg kunne læse uddrag af den.
Og kun uddrag af den. Ja. Så hvis du havde læst den hele, så havde du også vidst, hvad hele ideologien bag ved det var. Ja. Du... Og netop, jeg skal nævne en ting her, som er meget den generelle opfattelse, folk de har af satanisme, det er, at det er nogle folk, som er ondskabsfulde. De skal ud og have fat i små børn nede på legepladsen, op til alteret, og så er det ellers frem med kniven og drikke så meget blod som muligt. Det er den opfattelse, som kirken igennem årtusinder har prøvet at fremvise satanismen som værende. Der står i side 89 på den her, i den her bog øverst, under ingen omstændigheder vil en rigtig satanist nogensinde ofre et barn, men, eller for den sags skyld, noget som helst dyr. Det er sindssygt.
Men King, så vil jeg lige sige noget, fordi nu sidder du og siger, at de her ting har intet at gøre med satanisme. Men lad os prøve at tage din optræden for eksempel, hvor der sker utrolig mange uhyggelige ting på scenen, ja, og makabre ting. Tror, ja, du ikke, det påvirker de unge, at du gør sådan nogle ting på scenen, og samtidig siger privat i interviews, jeg er satanist?
Jeg tror, man skal passe på, at man ikke gør ungdommen til at være nogle små hjerneløse skabninger, som ikke kan tænke for sig selv. De ved udmærket godt, hvad der er godt og dårligt for dem selv. De ved udmærket godt, hvad de skal kunne lide, og hvad de ikke skal kunne lide. Det ved de udmærket også selv. Det er ikke noget med, altså, jeg tror ikke, du kan finde 3.000 satanister iblandt vores 400.000 fans, hvis jeg skal være helt ærlig. Ja. Og hvis du så kunne, det ville kun være godt, fordi jeg siger aldrig nogensinde noget i den stil med, at du skal slagte børn. Det står faktisk i Bibelen med Kain og Abel. Var der ikke en, der skulle slagte deres søn til ære for Gud?
Jeg synes, vi skal prøve at se en video, så se, og også kan få mulighed til at se, hvad det er, unge mennesker kigger på, når man ser en video af dine. Lad os prøve at se. Husker jeg, Bæk, så vil jeg lige spørge om din reaktion. Altså, er det skadeligt på nogen måde, at man ser sådan noget?
Ja, altså, det er da et budskab, man sender ud, altså, hvor de her synes, uhyggelige ting gør os til noget interessant og spændende. Ikke? Og det må hænge sammen med det budskab, man så også synger ud. Gør, hvad du vil, skal være opfyldelsen af loven, siger du i en sang med hvis nok et citat fra Crowley. Og det er noget af det, du vil, og det er noget af det, du holder frem. Og hvis satanismen er sådan noget fantastisk positivt noget, ikke, så vil jeg egentlig gerne se en større sammenhæng mellem det, du viser på scenen, og så en virkelig positiv relation til mennesker.
Nu skal jeg fortælle dig om den der linje, du siger, at du skal gøre, hvad du har lyst til. Do what thou wilt shall be the whole of the law. Det er, du er nødt til at efterleve med fornuft. Hvis ikke du kan det, så er du ude på tyndskidets marker, simpelthen for at sige det mildt. Ikke? Hvis jeg en dag er i studiet og laver plade, og jeg skal bare hjem og se Danmark banke England i fodbold, og så er der rødt lys foran mig. Når jeg kommer og siger, ja, så har jeg lyst til at køre over, for jeg skal hjem. Men jeg gør ikke, hvad jeg gerne vil, for jeg ved godt, der kan komme en lastmand fra siden af. Du er nødt til at efterleve de love, som et land nu er bygget op omkring osv. Der kan du ikke sætte sådan noget til side.
Ja, nogle gange tager du alligevel og lever nogle ting ud, uden at tage hensyn. Du siger også nogle gange, at de nærmeste, de er 10 gange vigtige, men mennesker, du overhovedet kommer i berøring med, de er ikke spor vigtige.
Ikke for mig.
Det sagde du lige før.
Helt klart. Det er de heller ikke. De er ikke spor vigtige for mig.
Og det mener jeg, at
folk, jeg ikke er berøring med, hvorfor skulle de være noget for mig?
Det er en dødsensfarlig holdning, fordi du møder nogle mennesker, der lider lige for de dør, som du måske ikke kender, som også har brug for hjælp.
Vi skal ikke tage hende over hovedet på dem.
Du kan ikke have følelser for noget, du aldrig har set eller hørt om.
King, nu vil jeg lige prøve at have Robert og Jesper ind i samtalen, fordi at vi har snakket om, at der er flere og flere unge, der viser interesse. Og det gør I. Bliver I nervøse eller lidt skræmte, når I hører fra en præst, at det er okkult og måske lidt farligt, det I beskæftiger jer med?
Det gør vi simpelthen ikke.
Nej, overhovedet ikke. Det gør vi ikke.
I er ikke bange for at lege med det eller lave eksperimenter, og så pludselig ikke selv kunne styre det?
Ikke så længe man kan sætte grænsen, nej.
Og det kan I godt?
Ja,
det kan vi godt, ja.
Så skal jeg her til sidst høre, Ole Skjærbæk. Synes du, at for eksempel de shows, som du kritiserer, som King laver, og de videoer, burde de forbydes i Danmark?
Det synes jeg ikke, fordi det gør det bare mere interessant. Men jeg synes, der er nogle ting, der er meget mere interessant end det. Altså, den overnaturlige verden, den er også til stede i kristendommen. Der skal lige så spændende ting, lige så stort indbrud i verden af noget stort og flot og helligt.
Jeg vil godt lige have lov at sige, at når man snakker om, hvad der er dårligt og godt for børn, hvad er alt det, I har lavet igennem tidens løb, korstogene, er det noget, du går ind for? Altså, nu, du må gå ind for kristendommen fra start til slut, så du går ind for korstogene, man omvender med sværet.
Der er ting, man...
Heksejagterne.
Der er ting, man skammer sig over som kristen, som man bekender for Gud og siger, at det her det er forkert. Sådan vil vi ikke blive ved med at leve.
Aha. Og så ved, at jeg ikke gør nogen som helst onde ting, så er jeg skidt alligevel. Fordi jeg siger, at vi lever, som vi gør. 99% af verdens befolkning lever efter den sataniske filosofi. De lever efter deres følelser.
der er brug for...
De har sex før deres ægteskaber. De lever efter deres følelse. Det gør vi alle sammen.
Det bliver det sidste ord i den her diskussion lige nu. Tak til alle fire. Tak fordi I kom.
And this is the News at Night. On tonight's show, Bruce Springsteen bids a fond farewell to Europe. The Red Hot Chili Peppers lose yet another guitarist. Ozzy Osbourne invites us to see some of his home movies. And we check out the bands, the fans and the suntans at last weekend's Dynamo Festival. First, Guns N' Roses, a two-day event attended by 50,000 metalheads who enjoyed the music of 17 bands. And this is what they got up to last weekend at the Dynamo.
Hi there, this is Vanessa Warwick for MTV News, reporting from Eindhoven in Holland. This is the Dynamo Festival 1993!
Hey, what's up? I'm Kenny Carade.
I'm Jerry Best.
I'm Dennis Chick.
Johnny Harrow.
I'm Mike Tramp, and we are
Freak of Nature. I'm just a freak of nature,
singing at all times, singing you know. And this is our first festival we've ever played, so probably we're going to be the best, of course.
What's up? This is Danny.
And Evan.
Billy.
And Bobby Hamble.
From Biohazard.
But we couldn't even put into words how special it is for us to be here, because this is like nothing we've ever done, ever.
We enjoy the festivals, you know. I mean, to us, it's a... I like playing outside, and I mean, it's better than playing in a club in front of 400 people, which is what we're going to do most of the rest of the tour. So, it's cool, too. Holland's a great country.
They're good.
Did you like them?
I don't know. They're a good band. Very metal, I think.
It's pretty amazing to be back doing it, you know, on a level like this, you know. I mean, I never thought it would get this big.
Vanessa Warwick reporting for MTV News from the Dynamo Festival in Eindhoven, Holland. Thank you.
Pretty amazing to see like all those maniacs in front of the stage slamming around.
It's been one of my dreams to play in front of a lot of people, and we were lucky enough a couple years ago to play with Judas Priest, but this is a lot more people, so it's fantastic. She's gone to live in.
But it's a very interesting challenge to play at a festival
50,
like this,
50, yeah. People, yeah.
With the sound and everything, you know, and a lot of people, yeah, sure. Come down into my
Okay, that's just about all we've got time for this special news report from the Dynamo Festival in Holland. If you'd like to see a more in-depth look at this great two-day event, then remember to check out the Headbangers Ball this Sunday and next Sunday at 11:30 in the evening, and I'll see you there.
Thank you.
and welcome back to the Headbangers Ball Dynamo Festival Special Part 2, bringing you all the action from the Sunday of this great festival. Brilliant lineup, as we've been seeing, I'm sure you'll agree. Now, the weather may have deteriorated a little bit, but I'm sure that's not going to put the dampers on the headlining act tonight. Merciful fate. And I'm joined by Henk and Michael. So welcome to you guys. And I was going to say that this was going to be a big bang gig for you coming back with Merciful Fate. But in fact, you did play just a little tiny small gig with Metallica a few days ago, didn't you? Tell us about that.
Yeah, we had this invitation from Metallica to play in as a warm-up in Denmark, where they were playing in Gentofte. Right. And of course, we accepted that. Yeah. So that was a very great experience for us. Good.
Just 30,000 people, so it wasn't very big.
Small one.
So that was actually the world premiere of this comeback with Merciful Fate. And, and now we are playing Dynamo tonight. Mm-hmm. And this was 10 years ago. It was the same country, the first country we played in when we were playing, 10 years ago. So this is, very like home, the second home for us, yeah. Good. That's great.
What comes around goes around.
Sure.
So when you disbanded Merciful Fate 10 years ago, you said it was because you couldn't continue with the intent of the band, that you didn't want to compromise. So why is it now right for you to get back together?
Well, I think at that time it was due to musical differences, sure. Mm-hmm. And then I have been playing some other bands. I have been playing a band called Social Mess together with Michael. And then we just started to compose in a more harder way, more harder heavy metal. Mm-hmm. And since we had a 1 year break off with Social Mess, and King Diamond had been inactive for about 3 years, it was very natural to just join the troops together again.
Mm-hmm. So we should actually mention that King Diamond isn't actually participating in the interview because he's got a little bit of a sore throat. He's saving his voice for tonight. But maybe Michael, what do you think? Can I just ask you this? What do you think that King Diamond got out of King Diamond that he wasn't able to do in Merciful Fate, and vice versa?
It was mainly because of the musical differences. We started writing songs very different, me, Hank, and King. So he had to make a decision, to carry on with the stuff he liked. So that's the reason why we had to split.
Okay. Well, we'll talk a little bit more in just a moment, but right now I think we'll just have a quick look at a video featuring King Diamond in solo mode, and then we'll be back with Hank and Michael in just a moment. Merciful Fate is still with me on the Headbangers Ball. You've got a new album out called In the Shadows. We'll talk about that in just a moment. But did you feel that it was important for the credibility of Merciful Fate to reform with the as many of the original members as possible?
That would be the most comfortable. We have been very good friends and are still are very good related to each other. So it was not a demand.
It was so clear from the beginning, that because we're all friends, we've seen each other during the years, and it was very easy to get the guys together again,
So was it a case of reinventing the band and its concept, or was it a case of taking up where you left off before?
Naturally, it has just as we now can see what the new album sounds like. It's kind of just which took off where we left, kind of same composing style, same type of music, and just we have been developing a little more in our technical side, and
so from that respect maybe you couldn't have made this album 10 years ago, so you've had like 10 years of experience to put into the new album, right? Do you feel it's kind of ironic now that you're coming back to compete with bands like Metallica, who were actually originally influenced by you? Is that kind of ironic?
I don't feel like heavy metal like a competition, we're just playing the music because we like it, and if other people like it, it's good, So I don't feel any threat or any competing with other bands, that's. That's a more business side, of the scene,
But it must be a great honor that Metallica mentioned you, and you get to play with them. Very kind of weird turn of events, isn't it?
A very nice experience, sure.
So tell us a little bit about the album In the Shadows, Michael. What can listeners expect from it?
It's very much in the same where we left it, with the Don't Break the Oath album. It's very much similar to that, but with a newer sound and better playing, in my opinion.
So Why did you feel that you could resurrect Melissa, as it were, and sort of finish that story?
Well, I think that it's a shame that King Diamond isn't present today, but I think that he would probably have told you a very long story about that. Mm-hmm. But I think he had some very good, you know, ideas for writing the lyrics for a new, mm-hmm. With this Melissa girl, you know, he had mm-hmm. some experience with, so.
Obviously.
Yeah.
Have you updated the lyrics to reflect what's going on in the 90s, do you think?
I think that basically King is writing about the same stuff, you know, but he has kind of toned down the words he used to use mm-hmm. In the 84s, you know. So actually it's about, you know, the same spiritual things going on in the world and everything.
Still very dark and very heavy and very powerful.
Maybe for some people it is probably a little dark, yeah. But okay. But otherwise the lyrics are very positive, you know, mm-hmm. Positive for humankind and everything, yeah.
Well, let's talk a little bit about the live show. What are you going to do with regards to the kind of theatrical side of things?
It's a bit different compared to the King Diamond project, because it was more like a theater, you know, with actors on stage and stuff. We are trying to make it more like a classic type of heavy rock band, you know.
But King's still going to be wearing the makeup?
Yeah, of course. Well, it wouldn't be King Diamond.
He's not going to unmask.
No.
So do you think in some ways that Merciful Fate might have been a little bit ahead of the times, and now that maybe the time is right for people to accept it more?
I don't know if we were ahead of time. So that what other people told us, but now, you know, we're just doing our music at the time we're doing it. So, mm-hmm. And I think it's maybe good timing for us, because I feel that the more classical heavy metal is kind of coming back, you know, and people wants to hear something more melodic, you know, very classical heavy metal things mm-hmm. instead of just a lot of energy loading out. So, of course, we are loading a lot of energy out in our music, but yeah.
Okay, very quickly, your plans for the next few weeks with Merciful Fate?
For the next few weeks, we're taking a rest, because we went to the States, made the video of the album, and now these shows here. So we take a few weeks off, and then we start planning on the US tour.
American tour.
Yeah, I think we are waiting for our record to be released on the 22nd of June mm-hmm. in America and in Europe, and then we have... after that, we are going to book some dates for US and Europe.
Okay.
So that's mainly the plans, yeah.
All right. Well, good luck tonight at the Dynamo Festival. Our best wishes to King Diamond to get his voice back for this big event tonight. 50,000 people to play in front of. It's great to see you back together and that you're all feeling really comfortable about it. So good luck with the new album, In the Shadows. And right now, we've talked about it. You've got to see it. This is Merciful Fate live on stage at the Dynamo Festival.
We'll be right back. fucking great. Thank you so much. Now here we go.
From the reunited, merciful fate just about rounds off this very special, in fact, two very special editions of the Headbangers Ball from the Dynamo Festival. And a little turning to Megadeth very shortly. We've got a little commercial break on the way. But before we go into that, I'd just like to introduce you to somebody who has no doubt been enjoying the show here today, and that is King Diamond. How are you doing? Have you had a good time today?
Very much so, yeah. Absolutely.
Now, we were at the Dynamo Festival where you headlined a couple of weekends ago. How did that go for you, King? Because I know that you had a little bit of a sore throat. You weren't able to do the interview with us. How did the gig go for you?
I managed to get through it, but it was very much because of the audience, because they gave a lot of energy, you know, and all this stuff. And I needed to press so hard with the muscles and everything just to get the right notes out. And it was tough, but... If there hadn't been so many and that crazy there, the audience, it would have been a hard time for me.
Because just prior to that, of course, you played with Metallica in Copenhagen. Yeah. And was that like a really good lifetime ambition for you to play with Metallica?
Absolutely, yeah. Absolutely. It was great. And then in Denmark, you know, in front of a home audience. And even though we played at 4 in the afternoon, broad daylight and everything, it's great. Everybody was like kind of like the Dynamo. It was just, there was 30,000 there.
Do you find it at all ironic that a band like Metallica, one of many bands influenced by you, are now that much higher above you and that you've come back kind of supporting them? Is that kind of ironic? How do you see it?
Not really, you know. It's like, you know, they've been going at it all the time. Merciful Fate stopped at a certain point, you know, where we might have taken it further as well. We don't know that. And I don't even want to look back and say, oh, I'm so sorry, maybe we could have done that. You know, there's no regrets. We did what we did, and we couldn't go on because there was different opinions on the musical style between Hank Sherman and me. Mm-hmm. And now he's back in his heaviest style ever. And it's like we've discussed a lot of things before we even started this whole project with Merciful Fate again. And it doesn't mean that King Diamond's not going to continue, because we already have the next album written. We're just looking for a deal in America right now. So, but we're going to give 100% for Merciful Fate, and there's going to be more albums for Merciful Fate too. So we're going to go 100% tour as much as we can for this album. Whenever we can't tour anymore this new album, then it's time for King Diamond to go in the studio and do one.
So the new album is called Into the Shadows, and it's out a little bit later this month. Very quickly, preview of that album?
It's very genuine Merciful Fate. There's no doubt. When you hear it, you'll be taken back to almost 85 style-wise. The sound is definitely updated, much better production, all this, but it's Merciful Fate the whole way through. There's no doubt about it. And I think all the members are really have learned a lot from being away from the band and doing different things. They got way better skill now. I can hear that on the album. They play much better. So they, right. Hank has been involved in some AOR kind of poppier version, you know, of stuff. A band, and it's done him some good, obviously. Okay, so yeah. It's good. We feel really good about it now.
Okay, and you're based in Los Angeles now, aren't you?
Dallas, Texas.
And you're happy about being over in the States?
Actually, yeah. It's very nice there. I used to live in LA at the time, but it was not quite my scene.
All right then, King Diamond. Thank you very much for talking to us. I'm going to let you go off and enjoy the rest of the Metallica gig. You can hear it there in the background behind us. We're going to have another short break right now, and then after that, we'll be back talking to Megadeth. So stay tuned. Thanks to King Diamond.
Difa, King Diamond og...
Hallo, hallo, København.
Ja. Jeg vil godt spørge, hvorfor er du længere hår end jeg har?
Ja, du forstår, oppe i Norden i Sverige, oppe i Sverige, så växer håret mycket snabbare, du vet. Mer öl, mer brudar.
Brudar, vet du?
Det betyder pia.
Pia?
Så får du håret till att växa.
King Diamond... Det er jo blevet et stort band efterhånden, og er det din skyld?
Bland annat, skulle jeg vilja sige. Nej, det går bra ihop. Det fungerer bra for os alle fem nu. Det fungerer fint, så at, det er en helhed.
Ja. Jeg tror, at der er mange her i København og Sjælland og omegn, der undrer sig over, hvorfor er der kommet to svensker med i King Diamond. Hvordan kan det lade sig gøre?
När jag var här nere i Köpenhamn och så hade vi en session, en jam session, jag och Michael Denner. Och fick några bajer och så manglade de trummis och gitarrist. För Hank Sherman och Kim Russ, de åkte ur bandet då, va? Och så kände jag Anders från Sverige.
Ja.
Så ringde vi upp han en natt klockan tre, så stod han här nere dagen efter vid ett, va? I centralstationen. Ho, bengon! Så körde det.
Ja, det er godt nok. Det er jo King Diamond, der kører hele showet. Altså, han sidder og styrer det hele hjemme for lejligheden, er det ikke rigtigt?
Jo, det gør han i og for sig, med mye hjælp da, fra vores manager Ole Bang og fra Erik Thomsen og mange andres hjælp.
Ja.
Men vi sköter det hele selv, så altså. Det gør vi.
Det er godt nok. I har lige været på en turné i USA?
Ja, det er et tag siden nu. Vi kom hjem i høstas. 86 och fjes. Och då har vi legat där ute i två månader lite över det. Och det gick gott. Det var både USA och Kanada.
Ja.
Så det.
Hur många jobb spelade ni?
Vad gjorde vi där? Gjorde vi 30 gig tror jag.
Ja,
30.
Är det pengar att tjäna i det?
Ja, det är det. Det är okej. Okay. Det rullar.
Det är något annat än här i Danmark.
Nej, det är något helt det är skillnad från hela Europa och USA och Europa, det är två helt skilda. Det är få skillnad till max. Det är mer rock and roll där över, alltså det är det. Där är den stora marknaden, speciellt då för King Diamond och för oss.
Hvordan är så nu imaget i King Diamond? Det är ju satanism, ikke?
Ja, det är Kings grej, det är det. Vi andra tycker om, jag personligen tycker mycket om det okulta, det heavy liksom. Så att men just den sataniska biten, den står King för.
Ja.
Det gör han.
Men är det inte någon som blir bange och liksom tar avstånd?
I bandet menar du?
Nej, jag menar mer publikum.
Jo, det finns ju alltid för och emot liksom. Det gör det ju med allting egentligen, va? Men efter att jag har lärt känna King och spelat med han så förstår man mer vad det handlar om och då blir man inte så bange.
Jag kan upplysa seerne om att King Diamond, han är faktiskt inte så slem som imaget går ud på. Han er en meget, meget flink fyr, og der er ikke noget med noget der.
Nej, det er det ikke. Det er en utroligt seriøs person.
Ja.
Mycket seriøs, arbetsam, rättvis og fair på alle sätt. Utrolig at jobbe med.
Ja. Jeg har lige fået udgivet en ny LP. Hvad hedder den?
Abigail.
Abigail?
Abigail.
Ja.
Og och det är ett PI-namn.
Ja.
Och hela den plattan är en story nu.
En historia på hela.
En historia.
Ja. Var har du inspelat den?
Samma ställe som Fatal Portrait och i Soundtrack här i Köpenhamn.
Soundtrack Studios i Köpenhamn?
Ja.
Hur lång tid var det?
2,5 månader var jag där.
Ja. Det var här i... Hvornår var det?
Vi gick in i december. Början på december och gick ur då i mitten av februari.
Ja.
Så att det var 2,5 månader. Ungefär samma tid som Fatal Portrait.
Och den kan man köra i...
Nej, den kommer ut den 27-28 april nu. Så.
28 april?
Ja, runt där.
Så det kan jag upplysa er om att King Diamond är på gaden den 28 april. Och vi önskar heller lycka.
Tack så mycket.
King Diamond is a Satanist who makes no bones at all about his beliefs. He's declared in a song, I renounce Christ the Deceiver.
I know people like to be scared, just a little bit, and they like that because they go watching all the horror movies. Yeah. And that's another thing, people don't like our lyrics, you know, because it says Satan now, then they go and watch Halloween or whatever it is.
Yeah.
So why don't they just accept our lyrics as, if they don't want to look for messages, then don't, just take it as horror stories, that's all.
You know, I'm not up to preaching to people, that's not what I want to do. I think people should believe whatever they want and we can be just as good friends no matter what religion you are. Believe in. I think it's important you believe in something. I don't want to preach, you know, but if people want to know something about it, I'm willing to discuss with them. I've had discussions on television in Denmark, you know,
yeah,
with priests and...
Oh, really?
Yeah, poor them, yeah. They can't answer my questions, unfortunately, because they go for a religion which was written down by a man's hand, actually, 2,000 years ago, you know, and they still go for that stuff. You know, I'd admit that half of the Bible is very good, and there are things that you can use today's society, but the other half is just too old, it's for the trash can.
One thing that occurs to me is that people would say that the devil is the greatest liar of all, and that he's probably sold you down the road, and that you're gravely deluded, and that you don't even know it. How would you respond to that?
The devil has never been allowed to speak for himself, never. He's always been called, Satan actually means the word, means the accuser, or the opposite. The accuser, he's never, you know, the Christians never say anything about what Satan is saying. He never says anything. It's the Christian that says, he's bad, he's doing this, he's doing that. Always a he, you know, it's
never
it's
heard
the power.
It's true.
I always, you know, when I talk to priests, for instance, and I tell them, you know, I just can't believe in a God, in God, because he's that evil. And he'll respond, you know, evil, what do you mean by that, you know? But if he is so all-powerful and almighty, why can't he come down to earth and show himself to people so that they can see that he's for real and that he's the guy to believe in. Instead he sits up in his head and goes, those people, they don't believe in me, and when that final day comes, I'm going to roast them in hell. And if that's not
terrifying,
if that's
idea.
Not evil, I don't know what evil is, but I can't believe in that philosophy. Let's get rid of all this old bullshit about Satanists drinking the blood of newborn children and things, because that's one big lie. It's something created by Christians, you know. Satanism isn't dangerous at all, you know. It's a very sound life philosophy, you know. Carry out your feelings, that's it. Have a good life, enjoy yourself while you're here. You don't know what's going to happen to you after this life. So why not get the most out of it?
We used to have a skull named Melissa, a real human skull. Unfortunately, it was stolen in Amsterdam, and it was the skull that we made the song after. But now we've got a new one. Just as human as the other one. So this one's got to be Melissa's sister. And she used to be a real... gypsy!
mexikaneren der.
King the seedle little head real quick again.
There now. Bring him on stage tonight. He's great.
Yeah.
Be like a little shrunken skull in a bigger place.
Hello, Mr. Officer.
Let's see. See, there's a ticket on the front windshield. Oh, you can't really see. You can see inside. Oh, where's the king?
Baby, real good. Yeah.
Every dog best on scrap old. Find the whole world. Hey, you got any more time? This is fun. Yidyo. Hello.
Smile.
Oh, will you? Look, look, there he is.
I want this.
Album Them and Conspiracy are one big horror story. They're connected totally. And we're trying to present all the entire story on stage, you know, but we're not playing the entire album Them. We're playing all the main songs from Them so that we get all the main characters, main events in there. And that's what we're starting off with. And then we do older stuff, you know, Miserable Fate stuff. We do older King Diamond stuff. And then finally we come to side one of the new album and we do the entire side one. The overall story is that, during Them, my grandmother had these weird sessions. She came out from an asylum, came back to her family to spend the last days, you know, with the family. She picked up on these weird tea parties again in the instant she was back in the old house, Amon. And, it got out of control. She got me into the stuff. And there's no way you can get out of it once you experience it, because that's like the best thing you could ever experience. Is being with them, feeling their warmth, drinking this tea with a little bit of blood in it. And that's what happened during the first one, you know. Then I finally know she killed my sister, or my grandma made them kill my sister. And finally, when she did that and the teapot broke, I freaked out and I realized what was going on. They also want to get rid of me because my mother is still scared of me. She's convinced from what Dr. Landau told her that I was the one who tried to kill her because of her open wounds, the cuts in her arm that were used for the tea. So she wants to get rid of me because she's scared of me as well. And maybe there's a little revenge in there as well, you know. They convinced the local priest to take part in this stuff so that they have an alibi. If one of them should start telling later on, the other one would have an alibi with the priest, so they're like, you know, securing themselves there by bringing him into it. And it's easy to bring him in because they just start talking about me being possessed by some kind of demon or maybe even Satan himself, you know. Then you've seen all the characters on stage, you've seen what happening, you know, you see you see the cremation thing, the burned alive thing, you know, where the priest and the doctor and my mother at the end puts me into this coffin and burns me alive on stage.
And keep in mind that we'll be come here at night.
And at the end of the show, you're gonna see me die. That's gonna be pretty heavy. That's gonna be a lot of surprises at the end of the show this time.
Good luck.
Thanks.
Good evening, all you metal vampires out there. I'm King Diamond. I'm gonna host the show here on the Headbangers Ball for the next couple of hours. Metal videos this hour is gonna be Great White, Aerosmith, Def Leppard, and we're starting things off with this, King Diamond's The Family Ghost. That's Aerosmith. Will let the music do the talking. I'm King Diamond here hosting on the Headbangers Ball, and I got a nasty little story to read to you. Listen carefully. Mary had a little lamb. His fleece was white as snow. And everywhere that Mary went, the lamb was sure to go. And we got more videos coming up now. Faster Pussycat, Def Leppard, and Motorhead. Hi, I'm King Diamond, your host on Headbangers Ball tonight. Here is the new video from Dio, I Could Have Been a Dreamer. King Diamond, your host on the Headbangers Ball tonight. The metal videos for this hour will be Rat, Wasp, Motley Crue, but we're starting things off here with Iron Maiden's Wasted Years. That's the latest from Wasp, Scream Until You Like It. I'm King Diamond, hosting here on the Headbangers Ball. And coming up right now, we got Motley Crue, Queensryche, and Judas Priest. I'm King Diamond. It's been a pleasure to be hosting this Headbangers Ball with all you metal vampires out there. It's time to say goodnight, but before we say goodnight, I'd like to introduce the entire band to you. We will be back here in America around January, February. Here, Mr. Timmy Hansen on the bass guitar.
We've got Mickey D on the drums. Right here's Andy LaRock on the lead guitar. And our new lead guitarist over here, Michael Moon. Thank you and good night. And here is AC/DC for those about to rock.
Macabre is already releasing some more vinyl. The EP is called Dark Sides and contains an array of previously unreleased but hard to find King Diamond recordings. Some of the tracks are the ultimate Fright Night anthem, Halloween, probably the rarest King Diamond recording, The Lake. It was previously only available on a 1986 limited edition picture disc. And just in time for the holidays, No Presents for Christmas, the first song from King Diamond after the demise of his band Mercyful Fate. Now, King Diamond isn't the only one ruffling people's feathers. In January, Overkill will release the CD version of their infamous UEP. The EP is currently available only on vinyl and cassette. Tonight, Overkill will finish their U.S. tour, and in January, the band will hit the European circuit as the opening act for Slayer. Right now,
Hello, I'm King Diamond. I'm here to host the Headbangers Ball for the next 3 hours. We've got one of my all-time favorite guitarists coming up next. He used to be in a band called Led Zeppelin. He's the one who got me going back in 69. Here he is, the song from his new album, Jimmy Page and Wasting My Time.
Todd, I'm Curry with you on the Headbangers Ball.
King Diamond, watch out for my upcoming tour. We start in a week from now. Now, here's Cinderella with Gypsy Road.
King Diamond will be back in a few minutes with you, but right now it's time for the Metal Detector, as the Cult are working on a follow-up to their Certified Gold Electric album.
You're all ready to go into the second hour of the Headbangers Ball. Coming up, we've got Guns N' Roses, Iron Maiden, and Alice Cooper. But first, we're gonna see the new King Diamond video. It's called Welcome Home, and it was shot at an old castle just outside London. Hope you like it. King Diamond, here's a look at the 10 best top-selling hard rock albums. The chart is compiled by Concrete Marketing, who survey independent record stores across the country. Number 10 is Driver with In God We Trust. MOD, Surfing MOD is number 9. Number 8, we got Savage Amusement from the Scorpions. Number 7 is Them from King Diamond. Van Halen at number 6 with OU812. Number 5 is Poison with Open Up and Say Ah. Cinderella is number 4 with Long Cold Winter. South of Heaven from Slayer at number 3. And at number 2, Def Leppard and Hysteria. And number 1, Guns N' Roses with Appetite for Destruction. Here they are now with
Sweet Your Terror. You've been on Elm Street. Welcome to a brand new nightmare. He is the first in fear. Second to none.
Don't let them put you to sleep.
He has no mercy.
Right now, I want to show you a video by the main influence in my career, a guy that I've always admired for the capability of how he could put himself right into the place that he was singing about. Here he is, Alice Cooper, with the song Freedom from his latest album. Hello, I'm King Diamond. As we mentioned earlier, we're heading out on tour in a week. So you better be out there. We're gonna bring the entire Them story out there for you. Playing the whole thing live. Got a 20 feet high house there. Grandma's gonna be on stage, the wheelchair, everything. My biggest dream right now is to get this stuff turned into a movie. I really hope someone is gonna do that for us. Right now, got another friend coming up, good old Lemmy and Motorhead from the movie. I'm King Diamond. I want to talk a little bit about some of the jewelry I'm wearing. Most of it has been given to me by fans, including this ring. This ring was given to me by a DJ in San Antonio, and it's a genuine old Mexican witch doctor ring. And actually, he was supposed to give it to me last summer, but it disappeared from where it should be, in a drawer. And when I came by this year on a promotion tour, suddenly it was right there in his drawer. And that's a genuine Mexican witch doctor ring, used for a lot of rituals and stuff.
Prophet, King's X, and M.O.D., and rumors are flying that the legendary...
Hello, I'm King Diamond. I'm about to say goodbye to you all, but before I do that, I'd like to say thank you to all you metal freaks out there who supported me in my internal struggle for some recognition here. Thank you very much. I hope to see you all on tour soon. Right now, we've got His Witness, and the song is Do It Till We Drop.
Being into heavy metal doesn't necessarily mean your kid's also into Satanism. And most of these fans are not. But there is an undeniable connection between obsession with the really hard stuff and the occult. This stone pony from Kansas City is named Spike.
The upside down cross is a symbol of Satan. Ozzy is a rock and roll singer. And most acid rock is involved with Satanism.
Let him who hath understanding reckon the number of the beast.
A heavy metal freak from Louisiana, Joe got himself into self-mutilation in Satan's name.
We'd cut our arms and let the blood drip into a cup, and we'd pass it around and drink from the cup, from each other's blood.
Kim from Colorado also practiced the gruesome ritual.
Violence with blood, we like to see blood, and we used to eat blood and stuff like that.
Drinking blood as entertainment is apparently a staple in the acts of heavy metalists like Wasp.
My life became centered not only around the marijuana I was smoking and the booze I was drinking, but it became centered around Satan.
Although Satanism is more obvious in the lyrics of groups like Megadeth, Slayer, Venom, and Iron Maiden, in St. Petersburg, Florida recently, satanic symbols filled the air at this concert by Danish-born King Diamond.
How much can you influence kids? I think people are too clever to be influenced by watching a band or listening to an album to go out and do the same, because if they were that easy to influence, watching the news, you get the real thing, and everybody knows that, right into your living room. Personally, I am a Satanist, a practicing Satanist, but we never tried to preach that religion to anybody.
Bull. An avowed Satanist, Diamond's protest that he's not preaching is belied by lyrics laced with references to death, graves, and evil. Of course, to some, it's just rock and roll rebellion.
Satan has nothing to do with this kind of a concert. It's just...
And I got a shirt.
And he got a shirt.
I feel much better.
We feel a lot better. Now, King, could you let us know about this new album? It's a Merciful Fate album.
That's right.
I understand. Called Return of the Vampire.
Yeah, Merciful Fate album coming out beginning of June. It is very old material, but it's in very good quality. It is stuff that we recorded before we ever got a record deal. And it's coming out now. I know there's a lot of people out there who like to hear certain songs. Burning the Cross, for instance, the 9.5 minute long song, and Return of the Vampire, the title track, songs that have never ever been on an album before. And there's a lot of other songs on there, which is different versions, different lyrics, you know, from songs that were later recorded and released on other albums, you know.
Hmm.
For instance, there's like a song called Death Kiss, that's one that later turned into A Dangerous Meeting, and different lyrics here, other riffs, and very interesting, actually.
Oh, that is interesting. So does this mean, like, Merciful Fate's gonna do another album, or what?
No, that's not what it means. what it could mean, you know, someday maybe, if we run into each other, all of us, you know, we might do a gig, you know. But it's not like Merciful Fate is, oh, starting over again, something like that.
Oh, okay, I see. Okay, so like King Diamond is doing now what?
King Diamond is at this very moment free of the old record deal with Roadrunner Records. We're off that deal, and we are now shopping for a major deal, and we have some very good lawyers working on that part for us. They have just started like 1 week back, so we hope to see some real good results pretty soon and get that deal done, and then we'll go into the studio in Dallas actually and record the next King Diamond album. All the material is written. We have like 11 songs ready, and the title of the album will be "The Spider's Lullaby."
I like that.
And
okay, so it's gonna be in Dallas then?
We're gonna record it in Dallas, yeah.
Why Dallas in particular? Just because it's close by here, where new base, right?
Yeah, it's close by my new base. I live in Dallas now. I'm a permanent resident of the United States now, as of the 14th of March. So
wow,
permanently staying in Dallas.
That's
so that's right. Where we're going to record. I'm not going to Europe to record. They can come here. The rest of the guys are coming here.
He's a Texas man now. You understand?
The boots?
All right. I know, those boots are bad. Okay, so is Diamond, are going to be the same members or new guys?
The band consists of Andy LaRocque, who's been with King Diamond ever since we started, and he's definitely still in there. He's you know, the co-writer of the material. And then we have Snowy Shaw on the drums, who've been there for a while. We have two new members. The guitarist is Mike Wett. He's from Stockholm, Sweden. And the bass player is Charlie D'Angelo. And you know, those are the two new guys. So now the whole band is from Sweden, except me, who's from Copenhagen, Denmark.
Wow.
But he's a Dallas man.
From now on.
Okay, and
that's cool.
I don't know.
So you guys gonna like tour? I know the album comes out like June 1st. Are you gonna like tour?
Yeah, not for the Merciful Fate album. We might, you know, King Diamond, when we tour, we always play Merciful Fate material.
Oh,
that we've
cool.
done ever since we started. So we, one song that's always going to be played is Come to the Sabbath in full length. And then we do a medley where we do like Satan's Fall, A Dangerous Meeting, Evil, a lot of things. And we'll probably pick one or two up from that new one that's coming out now that people have not heard it before, you know. We might play parts from Burning the Cross or Return of the Vampire. So, you know.
So you're going to get a lot of new material. Well, actually, a lot of old material that's done a different way, and a lot of new material.
Yeah,
the interview's so good.
And that's
I'm a stomp.
Yeah. Right.
I'm in the center. I am the guy balancing the shot.
Okay. So what can we expect to see, like, stage-wise?
We need that new album recorded first, and hopefully it'll be out sometime.
Be like
in the
a
autumn.
Theme thing, you know, with whatever the.
You know, we've done quite a few concept albums lately, and the thing is that this one here is not going to be a concept album. It's going to feature three songs that are forming a small story. That is, The Spider's Lullaby is one of them. The second song of that little trilogy is called East Man's Cure, and the last one is called Room 17, and it's about these, you know.
Yeah.
Ooh. And it's a nasty little story. The rest of the songs are individual songs, titles like 6 Feet Under, you know, and From the Other Side, The Poltergeist. But I didn't want to do another concept right now because I have enough concept in that book I've started writing.
A nice book. Exclusive.
Out.
Yeah.
You heard it here first.
Yeah. I've started putting the two albums, Them and Conspiracy, into book form now, and it's going pretty well. Those who've seen it so far, they want to see more.
Wow.
So I'm going back to before you ever hear, you know, anything on the albums, you know. I'm way before that, where I'm starting, you know. So you hear a lot of things. You know, you will find out how Grandpa died and all these weird things.
Oh, cool.
So there's a lot more put into that story, you know.
So does this book have, like, a title or something that, you know, that I can
The title at? Will be, you know, I could have called it Them or Conspiracy, since those two, but it's going to be called Grandma once it's done. You know, I'm aiming at trying to, if I find the time, you know, to finish it in '92. maybe beginning of 93. And then if it works out and people like it, those who will read it as a test, you know, then I'll go to the big publishers and see what they say. So that's why I said, maybe someday you might see that thing as a movie.
The movie, conspiracy.
The book, the movie, the TV series.
The man.
The myth.
The man.
I finally started working on that thing, so.
That's all right.
That's cool.
The one thing that I really wanted to know about, you know, is like all the stage annex and stuff like that. Now that.
Oh yeah.
That's the. Yeah. I mean, that's funner than we do all that. We hit each other.
Yeah, we hit each other, but it's not really. It's not real.
Well.
No, it's not real. You want to see real things, right?
Yeah, you know. I mean, you know, I want to see how
you want to see real cuts, real blood. Yeah, right? That's what you want to see.
Yeah, because I really don't believe myself that they don't do that stuff on stage. It's just props.
Yeah, right.
But that's a real knife, though.
This is a real knife.
I thought they had. They use fake knives, don't they?
This is real. That's real blood, and that's a real knife.
Wow.
That's real. Oh, dude, that's real.
That's real.
Well,
Hey, could you get me something? It's bleeding a little too much here. Could you get me something?
No.
And it's a sound.
Okay, I admit, it was real.
It's real, right there. You get a look at it.
Get a close-up on it.
Look at, that's real.
That's okay, what's left of it. We've almost stopped it now. But it took a few of these.
Yeah, but it bled quite a bit. You're not hemophiliac or nothing like that, right? That would, like, be good
it's
for his...
Okay
for his
it's okay now.
For his show if he was a hemo, right?
A prerequisite, actually.
Yeah, that'd be weird. There. Well, let's show the address for... the King Diamond Coven, it's P.O. Box 359, Elmendorf, Texas, 78112-0359. Kimmy would have done it, but he can't read.
Shut up, dude. Don't tell him. All right, so let's sum up here. We have the Merciful Fate album, old material, but you haven't heard it before.
Wrapped in a new package.
Wrapped in a brand new package.
Ooh. That's right.
June 1st, am I correct?
Just around, yeah, beginning of June, it'll be there.
Okay. And King Diamond, new band members.
Yeah.
And just working on a new album, hopefully out in the fall, right?
This autumn. And a book.
That's true, yeah.
He's busy.
Try to keep busy.
There aren't any, like, ghostwriters on this. You're writing it yourself and everything, right?
Oh, yeah.
Ooh. Maybe he could teach us.
I can't read. But, okay, so we'll keep that going. And the title of the new album that for King Diamond is going to be...
The Spider's Lullaby.
The Spider's Lullaby.
Yeah.
Ooh. Not a concept album all the way. Three songs, concept songs. And the rest is just outright jamming. So look for those. And it's great having you on, King Diamond.
Thanks a lot. Yeah. It's a pleasure being here.
Yeah, it's great.